Hi, in this video I'm going to show you in action another Angular feature which is called Directive Composition API. Feel free to use timecodes for this video to jump over the sections that might be not so interesting for you because I don't start immediately from Directive Composition API feature, but instead I'm showing alternative approaches, highlight their pros and cons, and then already we slightly come to the Directive Composition API, and there I demonstrate how you can solve the problems more elegant way by using this relatively new feature in Angular. Please have a look at these three different components. There is a button, chip, and banner. Even visually, you can already notice that all these three components have some common functionality. Namely, they all support different types of appearance like solid and stroked. However, if we check the source code of some of these components, we can notice that besides the appearance feature, they both have much more common things. For example, both support primary and secondary colors, they resolve the same way the host classes, and if we scroll there below, you can see also that both components handle a disabled state and prevent component native behavior if the user clicks on the disabled component. Simple and ugly, I would say. Ugly because we violated the dry principle and duplicated a lot of code. But how we could refactor this code to avoid code duplication? Well, the first and the easiest way we could think of is probably inheritance, right? So let's switch to the refactored code, which uses inheritance to share the common functionality. All right, it got better. The chip and banner components inherited the common inputs and other logic from the base class, and the derived classes contain only the logic which makes sense only for this concrete component. But we refactored only these two components, right? And let's try to do the same for the banner component. And as you can see, this component contains the same logic that base component already has. So I could simply remove this piece of code from here and just inherit that from the base component class like I did for the rest of the components. And it seems that it works fine. Even if you go to the browser and check your components, you can make sure that they remain working the same. However, we did something we didn't want to. Namely, we inherited also the support for the disabled state, which is not what I actually want to support in the banner component. For banner component, it just makes no sense. Definitely, it is a bad practice to expose API which should not be eventually used. But from another side, if I remove the code responsible for handling the disabled state from the base component class, then I would need to bring it back to button and chip component, and again, I would need to violate the dry design principle. This is one of the disadvantages you might encounter when you use inheritance. Though I don't want to state that inheritance is a pure evil, however, the truth is that inheritance isn't flexible enough. But is there any alternative solution? Well, sure, there is. We could simply extract each of the features from the base class into a separate Angular directive. So the disabled state would handle one directive, for the color would be responsible the second one, and for appearance would be responsible the third directive. After that, we could extend the component functionality by adding the corresponding directive and in such a way bring the desired behavior to the component. So let's have a look how it would look like. And here you can see that I've created three separate directives where each of them is responsible for its own piece of work. The canColor directive has corresponding input and applies a corresponding CSS class to the host element. The canAppearance directive does the same, but for the appearance, right? And eventually canDisabled directive handles the disabled state. So that's cool, because we follow the single responsibility principle as well as a dry principle, which is awesome. But let's have a look at how those directives are used. So you can see that we solve the problem of the API leaking to the banner component, because I explicitly define which exact features it supports by bringing the corresponding directives. So it doesn't have the disabled functionality. And it's good. It is flexible. Flexible like a hell. And I can actually orchestrate with that as I want by adding or removing directives and so on. But it comes also with costs. The disadvantage here is quite obvious, because I have to explicitly apply directives to the component host element each time when I want to use this component. And in my exact use case, it brings a lot of inconveniences, because I want to have this functionality for each button and chip component. So that's why I have to repeat a lot of code in the template. And this is where Dirctive Composition API comes in handy, because it allows to declare the host directives from the component and not from the template. So let's see it in action by refactoring the button component using this new API. So if you use Angular 14 or newer, you should be able to utilize the host directives property in the component annotation. This is an array where you can declare directives that have to be applied to the host element of this button component automatically. So in my case, it will be the can disable and obviously can appearance directives. And it means that now I can simply remove those directives from the component host element. Now you might notice that I have an error which says that it cannot apply the appearance property because it is unknown property for the button component. And you might think that Composition API didn't work. Actually, it worked, and the canAppearance directive was successfully applied. The problem is that by default, all host directive inputs and outputs are kind of private, and they are not exposed for the public usage. You have to manually expose inputs that can be available in the template. To expose inputs and outputs, you have to refactor the code a little bit, and you have to provide an object with a key directive, and then you have to add property inputs, where as an array of strings you provide the list of inputs that have to be publicly exposed. In my case, it is appearance, so I will just define it right here inside the array. And as you can see, the error is disappeared. But don't worry if you make a typo here, because Angular Language Service will detect it and you will see an error that says that, okay, you're trying to expose the input which doesn't exist for that particular directive. It also supports aliasing, and if you want to expose the input under a different name, then just use the column sign and provide the alternative name for it. After that, in the template, the input will be available under this new name. And absolutely the same thing is applicable also for host directive outputs, but obviously instead of inputs, you should use a key called outputs, and in the same manner you can publicly expose the outputs. And I don't have any outputs in my host directives, so I will just revert it, but I hope you understood the idea how you could use that. Okay, now let's try to finish our refactoring by exposing inputs from other directives, so we could provide also values for it, right? So I have done it for the can disable directive, and also the same I'm going to do also for the can color directive. And here I can expose the input color that is provided by this directive. Then I could also apply the array of directives to the chip component, which I will, let me drag it next to the button component. So here we go. And Then let's just add the host directive array to this directive, and we have to import obviously all the missing imports. Great, and let's maybe remove also aliasing from the appearance input. For the button components, I used aliasing just to show you the feature. But for this component, I don't really need it. Then also let's do the same for the banner component. Well, I go there and in the component annotation, I will add the same array to the host directives, right? But since my banner doesn't support the disabled state, so I'm going to remove the corresponding directive and leave only those two ones. Great. Now I can actually clean up my template and remove those directives from the template because they will be automatically added to the host element when the component is being created, right? And last but not least, I can go to the app component TS file and also remove those directives from the import array because we don't use them in the app component template anymore. So I can just safely remove them. Awesome. And if you go and check how everything looks in the browser, you can see that all components work absolutely fine. So this was a Dirctive Composition API in action, but let's continue exploring this feature further. In fact, the host directives can be used not only with components like we did it before, but also with other directives. And you can create directives that apply other directives, so to say. And for demo purposes, let's split the can disable directive into two separate directives where the original can disable directive will be handling the disabled state, but the logic which prevents default behavior, it will be extracted into a separate directive. And for that, let's maybe close all the tabs except the can disable directive, and let's generate a new directive by using the Angular CLI, and for that I will just use the following simple command. So I hit enter and here we go, my directive was generated, and then let's open them next to each other just like that. So as I said before, the prevent default logic moves away, so let's cut it from this directive and just paste it into the new one right here. And of course, again, I have to import all the missing stuff. Brilliant. And to not forget, let's immediately go to the can disable directive and just add this new prevent default directive as a host directive for can disable one. Okay, that's cool. But how prevent default directive can read the value, the state from the can disable directive? Well, you can use dependency injection and simply inject the can disable directive. So let's do it right now. And depending on your use case, you probably would like to have this injected directive optional. So for that, you could use the corresponding optional resolution modifier. But just to keep this example simple, I don't do that. But we have to move forward. And right after I injected this directive, I can simply read the disabled state from it and I can perform logic accordingly, because inside the can disable dir property there will be an instance of the can disable directive which resides on the same node with the can prevent default one. By the way, this nice console log output is a result of working the VS Code extension called Console Ninja. This is very handy extension that kind of brings a browser console right in your editor and place it right next to your code, which is very convenient because you don't need to switch the context and jump to the browser to see what was console logged. This extension has a free community version, which I currently use, so you can also simply install it and play around with this extension. And if you like the experience, you can also go with a pro version that has much more cool features. And yeah, if you are interested, you can find the link to this extension in the video description. I've been using this extension for a couple of weeks, and yeah, so far so good. I really enjoy this extension, and it comes in really handy for me. But yeah, let's get back to our code and test out our current changes. So let's go and remove this constructor first of all, and then I will just console log the event I received for this method, and it is going to display if the default behavior was actually prevented or not. All right, so now let's maybe go and disable one of our buttons in the application template. And maybe let's also make this button not as a HTML button, but as a link that just looks like a button, okay? And this link has a default behavior, so it navigates to another page by default, right? So it will be easy to see if the default behavior was prevented, because theoretically the navigation should be prevented if this button is disabled. So yeah, let's make a little bit convenient the layout and bring the browser next to it. So here you can see the disabled button, which is, we remember, is actually the link. And if I click this link, the console ninja prints true, which means that the default behavior was prevented and navigation didn't actually happen. But if I go and enable this button, then you can see that when I click this button again, the value false was printed out, which is obvious because the button isn't disabled. What is also interesting is that if you are not planning to use the directive separately, if you are going to use it always as a host directive, then you can also drop the selector. Because if the directive is used as a host directive, then its selector is being ignored anyway. But to be honest, I don't know if it is a good practice to drop a selector, maybe not. Actually, if you want to discuss it, I would like to hear your opinion, your thoughts in the comments. But the only thing you for sure should not remove, it is a standalone flag, because otherwise you will get an error, because host directives can be only standalone directive. Yeah, this is the only one limitation. So as you can see, it is really cool feature, but yeah, before you go, I would like to mention that please do not go crazy with this feature. Just keep in mind that for each directive will be also created a corresponding class instance. And if you render hundreds or thousands of buttons, for example, if you render the button in the huge table, then your application will allocate much more memory and it might cause some performance issues. All right, guys, that was it. I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you learned something new today. And if so, please share this video with your colleagues and friends. And also, don't forget to leave your thoughts in the comment section and check out my advanced Angular courses to level up your Angular skills. The link will be in the video description. But now, I wish you a productive week ahead. Stay safe and see you in the next video.